welcome to the show again.
Hello again.
I must say, I feel like a butterfly up here, like you're looking over, down and everything.
I know.
Like
did you see that pool?
Unbelievable. Truly really unbelievable. Cool. Now, the album is about to come out.
Mm-hmm.
The first single, Honey, which is obviously a great taste for the album. An amazing track.
Thank
and also an amazing collaboration. So let's go with Honey first off.
Okay. Well, the original idea for the loop that Honey is basically written on top of is a song called Body Rock by the Treacherous Three from like the early 80s. And Q-Tip of A Tribe Called Quest came up with the idea, and he played it for me over the phone. And I knew I didn't have my first single yet. I was going back and forth with it. Puffy and I wanted to collaborate, do the first single, do a couple of things, but we were kind of going back and forth with stuff. So, and I had songs that I liked, but I knew it wasn't exactly what I wanted yet. So he played me this song, and I was like, that's it. I knew when I heard that little bass line part, just that it was right. So, you know, I wrote the song on top of it. And then we all kind of got together, Puffy, Stevie J, and I, and put the Hey DJ little part on top of it, and made that the bridge and the intro, and so it was like a major kind of group effort on that song.
So, I mean, was this in your mind that this would be the first single, or was just another track, but...
It was in my mind that it'd be the first single. Definitely.
I mean, would it be fair to say, like with Fantasy, that we were starting to get a taste of Mariah going that way, you know?
Uh-huh.
Certainly with the mixes, the remixes that you did.
Right.
You?
Well, it kind of started with Dream Lover, which is a pop record, but, you know, if you really listen to it, you can hear the loop underneath it. It's like been used on a lot of rap records. It's not like a soft bass, but on top of it is what, you know, the song is happy and stuff like that. So that kind of started my trend and my own first single thing. But so then we did the remix on this one with Mace and the Lox and Puffy. And Puffy and I first worked together when we did Fantasy
yeah.
with ODB.
Yeah.
Who
Which
I just
was
saw.
Great.
Just saw him the other night.
How is he?
He's good. He was like in this hotel. I was next door and I heard that the Wu-Tang Clan was over there, so I ran over. And he was like in the lobby with like a Hawaiian lei on. I guess I just got back from Hawaii, and like a big rice farmer's hat and this crazy outfit. It was really great to see him.
So, I mean, okay, so you worked with Puffy then, and then...
We decided that we wanted to, you know, after the success of that and how the collaboration really worked, you know, it was like a mutual thing. We wanted to work together again. So we did the first single, Honey, and I actually just shot the remix video 2 nights ago.
Well, there's 12 mixes already of Honey.
There's about 43 mixes of the song. No, I did a club remix with David Morales,
which is great.
Thank you.
I mean, you and David you and David really have a certain magic towards each other, you know?
Right. Yeah, he's incredible because he really has he's on the pulse of the world in terms of the club underground music. So when we work together, it's like I give him the freedom to go all out because I can rewrite my songs on top of what he does. And a lot of people, if you don't write your songs and you're not flexible with, you know, where you can sing the melodies over things, it's a little harder for the remixer because they have to kind of make the vocals fit the song. But he and I, what we do is we basically write a whole new, you know, rewrite it. You know, he does a new bed of music and I just take it to another place with the vocals and stuff.
Okay, so now you've done the rap video or the new a remix and almost like a remix video, right?
Yes, it's
just,
definitely a remix.
Just completed
video.
That yesterday?
We did it. Well, I'm going to go edit it tonight, but we shot it 2 days ago. Was it 2 days ago? I don't even remember now. Yeah, 2 days ago. It's all blending into one because I'm working so hard and still not quite done with the album. But yeah, we did. You know where I'm on the jet skis in the regular video? Okay, so instead of going to the island, I see this helicopter flying in. It's a black helicopter. It's got Honey on the side and a picture of me like a Vargas girl on the side. And it's Mace and the Lox, and they're coming to rescue me. So they pull me up on this, like, I don't know how many, 30-foot cord, and reel me in. I did my own stunts. I'll have you know that there's no stunt girl on that shoot. I didn't jump off the building.
I was going to say, that's pretty believing, though. I mean, visually, off the building, it looks pretty good.
That one was good. But I did dive in the pool.
Right.
Apple boxes and Gucci pumps that high. So I deserve a little bit of recognition for that. No, but so on this one, I was like...
Because yeah, they're hardly flippers, are they?
Yeah, exactly. They're like, you know, steel heels. So in this one, they had me hoisted up on this rope, and I'm like, I'm looking at this at the, I guess it was a stunt coordinator, and he's showing it to me. He's like, okay, so this is what you're gonna do. Watch the monitor. And it's like, whoosh, all of a sudden, I see the guy goes flying up in the air. I'm like, I'm gonna go that fast? Because I'm adventurous, but I mean, there's a limit to what we're talking about here. It's only a video. But, you know, so I just said, let me try it and we'll see. So they're like, well, we better tape it because it might be the only time you do it. So we tried it and I ended up doing it 3 or 4 times. It wasn't that bad. But so then they pick me up and Mace rescues me. And then we end up in this water tunnel. Puffy, Mace, and Nalox, and all of us, and Stevie J, and, you know.
And that's the end of that video.
Mm-hmm. It's basically could be a whole new video, but we're going to cut it in with the first one. And use
the end of the first one, actually. Huh? I'm joking.
I'm going to use some different stuff from the skit in the beginning because there's things we didn't use that are hysterically funny, like, of Eddie Griffin, the comedian with the gum, and stuff like that. Really, really funny stuff.
Now, with Fantasy, it was one of your first, with the video, of having fun and directing. Are you doing a lot more of that?
Well, I mean, this video was my concept, the whole thing, and I went to Paul Hunter with it, and then he kind of, you know, came up with a couple different things, but, I mean, I could have said, we could have co-directed it, I could have said, you know, I just want to get a DP and direct it, but it's too stressful sometimes, especially for the first single. I just really felt like, you know, participating in it and contributing creatively, but not having the full pressure on me.
All right, let's get off Honey. Now, I don't know if this is the track listing because you really haven't set the track listing with the album.
Well, I have, but they don't have all the songs yet.
Butterfly, the title track.
Mm-hmm.
A song you wrote with Walter.
Yes.
Before we get into Butterfly, Honey, the vocal approach. Some people go, wow, is that Mariah singing like, you know, a new way? And it's not really, but it's sort of, it's very, I mean, I love the way the vocals are and the way they sit in Honey, you know?
You mean the backgrounds and the lead
and your own lead vocal, you know? It just all...
He said to me, it sounds different. And to me, it doesn't sound different from my... To me, it sounds very close to, like, Fantasy or something. But I think what it might be is that the key is sort of in a different place.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as high. So I'm singing more in my middle register for, like, the verses. And I actually had a little rasp to my voice on the day that I sang that. So it might sound a little bit, like, grittier in some spots. I don't know. The backgrounds are... That song, because it's written over a 2-bar loop that's pretty basic, they needed a lot of... It's all about the vocal arrangement that gives the song the dynamics. Because it's not like there's a lot of chord changes or anything.
Right.
So that was the main thing. It took me a while to figure out how I was going to give the song, dynamics and stuff.
Okay, Butterfly.
Mm-hmm.
You wrote this song with Walter.
Actually, I wrote this song. I came up with the idea for Butterfly, and it was originally going to be a house record. I was going to just do it with David Morales.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, the mix that's on there,
yeah.
Fly Away, that was my original concept for the song.
Oh, I see. Right.
And I had the lyrics to that part, and then I started working on it a little further, and I said, you know, this should really be the title of the album, and this should be a ballad.
Mm.
So I went to Walter, and I already had written most of it, and I just said, this is the song, basically, and then we did the bridge and stuff and worked it out.
Well, again, the vocals in this are different to Honey, but I just love it again. It's so subtle where you've got the arrangements sort of slightly soaring in a way, but you seem to weave around that, you know?
Right.
When you're writing something with you and Walter, do you arrange it then, or does it happen within the studios when you hear the backing arrangements? And I mean, I'm not sure how you do that with your vocals and the arrangements.
With that particular song, because I had such a specific vision when I went into the writing of it. I mean, sometimes it'll be like we'll sit down and we'll sort of collaboratively, you know, decide where the song's gonna go. This song, I knew it before I went there. This is the song. It's gonna be these background vocals. I wanna do a really simple verse. I wanted the verses to be kind of much more inward, you know, feeling like small and quiet and subtle, and then the choruses really open up and they become so big. And the vocal arrangements were basically in my mind, but then on the bridge we did the vocal arrangements. I did them with on the spot as we were recording, Melanie Daniels and I. And she's an incredible singer.
Yeah, she sure is.
Yeah, she's really great. So we all, and her friend Marianne sang on that song too. So we all kind of, it was very free feeling. I recorded that song in the Bahamas. I did the vocals in the Bahamas, my leads. And it was like a really great place because it's Chris Blackwell's studio on the ocean. And so I worked
very
around.
Peaceful.
Sorry?
It's very peaceful there. I mean.
Yeah, it's really peaceful. And it's a really great creative environment because you can go outside and it's very inspiring. I worked till 3 and 4 in the morning, but it didn't feel like it because it was just like, you know, totally relaxed.
Right, now, we're jumping here, but then Fly Away, which is the reprise, Butterfly's reprise, you joined with Bernie Taupin to do some of the lyrics?
No, what I did was I sang as an ad-lib, Butterflies Are Free to Fly, Fly Away, Bye Bye, which is from...
Right.
You know, yeah. Someone Saved My Life Tonight.
Yeah.
And so those are his lyrics, and I sang them as an ad-lib over and over. So, you know, you credit.
Yeah, right. And then David, of course, is involved with this as well, with the reprise.
Right.
And it's, I mean, it's just totally different.
Right, but as just, a, yeah, it's was
it's
the
got
original
a great feel too.
Inspiration. I think it works because it was the original idea, was just to be that kind of a song.
Yeah. And the feel of that is good. That's, again, where I say with you and David, it works so well.
I love
that. All right, going back to the next song I heard today. Now, this one I love already is The Roof.
That's my favorite song on the album.
Oh, I love it.
Thank you. I did it with the Trackmasters. Mm-hmm. They do Foxy Brown, Nas, The Firm, a lot of people. And they're really, really cool people. They did Allure, the group on my label. Yeah, and they have a new single coming out, All Cried Out, which is the Lisa cover, and it's a duet with 112, Puffy's group. It's really good, that singing on Missing You. So, but anyway, what were we talking about? The Trackmasters, yeah. So I had an idea to use this sample from Mobb Deep. It's called The Shook Ones, and it's like one of my favorite records. And every time I heard that loop, I always knew that I wanted to use it. And so I went to those guys, and you know, we put it together. But we also changed it and changed the music, and let it not be just a straight loop all the way through. You know.
I mean, it gives another different approach the way you sing, but it's got. I mean, the lyrics are fantastic. I mean, it's very complicated. I mean, we even try to follow the lyrics, you know, with all the different harmonies and that coming through. And there, obviously, there's a couple of different versions of that.
Well, there's only one version that's going to be on the album, but we're going to do a remix, hopefully, with Mobb Deep, the guys who did the original record. And they've never done it.
It's a great track. It has to be a single, I've got to tell you.
I'm hoping what it's going to be is Butterfly and The Roof as a sort of double A-side.
All right, now, My All. This is getting serious, this track, you know? I figure it's getting serious. Is it?
What do you mean, getting serious?
Well, the lyrics are very, you know...
What do you mean?
Well, what I mean, what do I... is part of Mariah coming out in these lyrics? I mean, in a big way, you know?
Possibly. Possibly not. No. Yeah, definitely. This album is... There are so many things about it that it really are very personal. And I mean, I've lived with it much more than I've lived with any of my other albums. Like, I go to sleep to it every night. And it's kind of strange that I'm gonna be putting it out. It's weird to me. Like, I was just thinking the other day, I can't believe this is gonna be coming out soon. Like, it's so much of me that's gone into it, more so than any other record.
Well, if you go from The Roof, right, if this was the track, what's the track missing I heard today? And then you go to My All, before you even get to the lyrics. I mean, there's this wonderful guitar and acoustic type of feel, you know, and then this song takes off, you know.
My All?
Yeah.
What I think I was going to do is Honey, Butterfly, My All, then The Roof.
Right.
Because I want to give a little space between Honey and The Roof because they're both up tempos, but I don't know. You can help me out with that if you want.
So when did, when you wrote this song?
My All.
Yeah.
I wrote it after I came back from Puerto Rico, and it, not from the video, but another trip. And it's very, I guess I was in that whole Spanish kind of vibe.
Latin Spanish, yeah, it's got that feel.
Yeah, definitely, it's got a Latin feel. And we were in the studio working on other songs, Walter and I, and I started singing him that melody.
Mm-hmm.
And we just did it, and I wanted to keep it really simple. I think it's lush, but it's simple.
Yeah.
You know, it's big, but it's also intimate feeling, so I like that one a lot.
All right, now where the next track I heard, and this one also, I mean, this takes you on a real ride. I know you like roller coaster rides.
Yes, I do.
Wherever you call.
Whenever you call.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, this is Mariah, as maybe other people say, oh, this is Mariah singing now. You know?
Right.
I mean, this is...
That's
really...
it's more of the traditional style of ballad, like more in the hero kind of feeling.
Yeah.
But I tried to keep that one as underproduced as I could for the type of song that it is. I didn't want it to get too overblown, but I like it a lot. I mean, it's hard sequencing because I do have so many different kinds of records on this album. But I think it's good because I've maintained true to myself in every way, like staying who I am in terms of doing the ballads and doing the things that I love to do. But being able to do the collaborations like with Bone Thugs and, you know, with...
We'll get back to, down to that. That's fantastic, that one.
And, you know, the other stuff.
All right, with Whenever You Call, I mean, you know, there's great ballad writers, and I mean, you've worked with David Foster, but you and Walter seem to have this cleverness of... And this one is clever. I mean, it's a ballad, you know?
Thank you.
And it's you singing it, you know?
Right. You know, we wrote that one early on in the whole process of the album, and I don't know. I mean, I guess we have a sort of unique style, the way we work together and the way we write, because he's so classically trained. He'll sometimes play something when he's following me that someone else wouldn't do.
Mm-hmm.
He's not, you know, when we work together, when we do these ballads, I try to steer it in a direction that's less predictable. Mm-hmm. You know,
did like even the tracks we've mentioned, do you have to go away or go in to the studio with a frame of mind? I mean, I can't imagine, for instance, well, the next track, Baby Doll, but I can't imagine you doing them all on the same night. I mean,
no.
You're doing that track and that track maybe within 2 days of each other, you know?
No, what I do is I do the ballads first, usually with all my albums. The last three. It's like I do the ballads and then I get into the mindset of doing the up-tempos because also styles change, trends change, things happen.
Sure.
And it's just, you know, it's better. And when I go into like the ballad headspace and do that and then I work towards the up-tempos. But it got a little bit jumbled this time because I wrote Butterfly later on in the project than in the... I wrote like... Whenever You Call, 4th of July, and Outside, earlier in the project.
Right.
And then Butterfly, My All, towards the middle, to the end, and The Roof, and all those, and then Honey, and Breakdown, and all the other ones towards the end.
Okay, so you get over the ballad, and this is also the track listing we heard today, Baby Doll.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is adventurous.
Mm-hmm. I wrote that with Missy Elliott.
Yes.
And do you guys, is Missy... big down there?
Yeah. Well, she's breaking down there.
Okay, so they have I Can't Stand the Rain, so they're...
Yeah.
So I really wanted to work with her because I think she's a great writer, and she's really on the cutting edge of R&B, where R&B is going. And
great voice, too.
Yeah, she's got a great voice, and that's... When I first heard her, it was on an MC Lyte record, I think that Puffy had done.
Yeah.
And she was rapping, and the first time I heard her do that hee-hee-hee-how thing, and then she was singing, and I'm like, the same girl that's singing is the one that's rapping right there? And then I started hearing more of her music and the songs she wrote for other people, like Aaliyah and stuff. So we got together, and I had already written the hook, I Want to Be Your Baby Doll, that whole part. But what was different about that, I went to Virginia, I met her, I met Timberland, we did the whole thing, and she's just really cool. And, you know, I said, how would you approach this melody in the verses? Because I already had an idea for what I would have done, but it was much more of my style, like more free, kind of flowing over the music. And she approaches things from like more of the repetition, like a rhythmic thing. So she started with the da-na-na, that little thing that we did with the 211, that little part. can't sing today, didn't get enough sleep, we won't go into that. But so she and I collaborated on the lyrics, and we wrote it in the hotel room. We were drinking champagne. She was already hungover from the night before. She fell asleep halfway through the writing session, so I had to finish it alone. And she knows I'm going to tell people that, so she doesn't care. Because she had been to Timberland's party the night before, so yeah. She was tired. So on the back of on the album credits, that's why I said, no more Cristal for you. She couldn't handle it, but it was good. She really added a new dimension to that.
Now, I mean, I've known you for such a long time, but I try to explain to people at home, and we'll get onto that in a moment about you coming down, but a lot of people wouldn't understand or probably comprehend that there's one Mariah Carey that is the performer singer, and that's, well, you know, and the glam and everything else, would find it hard to imagine that you're mixing with all these urban music people, rap people, have complete knowledge of it. A lot of people just can't comprehend that, you know? How do you are able to mix, you know, your day sort of thing, or your week, you know, or your year, you know, being able to come in touch and be part of this, of that sort of lifestyle, that sort of life.
It's not even like, it's a conscious thing. It's like, I'm the type of person when I form relationships with people creatively, if we connect, I usually form, a friendship with people. And, you know I have this image as like, I guess, in some ways, this unreachable, whatever this Cinderella thing that someone made up and they stuck to it.
Right.
I didn't grow up in that. I came from a very difficult upbringing, you know, and went through a lot and saw a lot of things. And a lot of people that I'm working with, we have a lot in common in terms of that. So it's not like I was this little girl and I was like, oh, rappers, yay, I can't wait to go work with some rappers and then I'll really be cool. You know, like that. It's not like I had this sheltered upbringing, you know. It's actually further away from my personality to be like this removed princess thing than to be with people my own age doing the type of music that I listen to, that I love, that are successful, creative people. So it only makes sense to be working with like Puffy and Q-Tip and Missy and Jermaine, Brat, all the people that are even Boys to Men, you know, because we all have a common bond, you know, and it's like I'm influenced by R&B. I've always been influenced by R&B and urban music. I grew up in New York listening to urban radio, you know, from the beginning of hip hop to now to, you know, to beyond. So it's not like suddenly I'm like, whoa, she's changing. It's like this big deal. It's what I've always loved to listen to. Yeah. It's just when the label or people get used to something that sells for you, it's always easier to keep you kind of doing what works. But what people need to realize is that the audience is capable of dealing with change.
Yeah. Well, I mean, indeed, in this album, as I said before, it's like not a roller coaster, but it takes you through different feelings, musical styles, and it all sort of fits, you know, it really works well, you know. And that's not the track listing, as we said before.
Right.
All right, 4th of July. This is an interesting track, you know, another one that you wrote with Walter.
Uh-huh. It's sort of, my favorite song off the last album was Underneath the Stars.
Well, we talked about the last time. That's a great track.
Thank you. And so 4th of July was one of the first ones that I wrote for this album. And it was sort of, I was still so into Underneath the Stars that we were sort of continuing in that 70s feeling. And lyrically, I really wanted to kind of paint a picture. Like when you listen to the song and you read the lyrics, it's very visual in a lot of ways and moody.
I mean, okay, when did you write that song? When you were writing the ballad, you said, right?
I wrote that early on.
Yeah. And when you write songs like that, do you go in and do like a back and track demo of it so that you don't forget it, or
when I write anything?
I mean, you're a tape freak, you put things down.
I put things down sometimes. Well, when I'm writing, we run a DAT the whole time, usually now. I mean, in the beginning, it was much more loose when I didn't have all those luxuries, like having a DAT thing that runs and someone running it and all that. But, you know, or we run a cassette or something so I don't forget the melody ideas. Because that's the thing that I do, which is why I like to collaborate with people who are better at playing than I am. Because I come up with all these melodies and I'll forget it. Like 5 minutes later, I'll be like, what was I just singing? You know, and I do that all the time and everybody laughs because I can come up with a melody in a second, but I can forget it like just as quickly. So, you know, I keep all those on a cassette. Then I go and write the lyrics afterwards. And sometimes when it's a gift, half the lyrics come off the top of my head while I'm writing the melody.
I mean, even with the last album, you're a very generous person. I mean, like, for instance, when you did the Boys to Men track, I mean, it wasn't Mariah Carey featuring Boys to Men. It was like you insisted that the credits were there, the performance, the even, you know, performance itself was there, you know? Mm-hmm. Do you love working with people? I mean...
Yeah, I love collaborating with people, especially like doing different things, like this record we did with Bone Thugs. Well, it's actually Crazy and Wishbone.
Yeah.
And I was very inspired by them when I wrote the song.
This is Breakdown, right?
Breakdown.
Okay, we've got to just tell the song.
Right. Okay.
This is great.
Thank you.
This, because I love Bone Thugs and Harmony.
Yeah.
And I had the pleasure in this city, actually, of interviewing them, and I was dreading it, but it was probably one of the most enjoyable interviews, you know, talking about Cleveland and the whole thing.
Right.
With Eazy-E and that, you know?
Uh-huh.
And your, this track, Breakdown, tell us about it right now.
Okay, well, I did it with Puffy and Stevie J, and I said that I wanted to do a Bone Thugs-esque record. So they were like, okay. Just like when I went to him and said, I want to put ODB on this, and this is my thing. So sometimes I think like I shock people with the ideas that I come up with, but you know, he was definitely into it. But it's just like an odd, another odd collaboration that you wouldn't expect. But I think it worked out really well.
It does.
Because they're so unique. Their style is so unique, and it's really starting to influence a lot of other people musically. Like, you can tell there's a lot of records coming out kind of doing their sound. And I really wanted to work with them. And so I wrote this. When I wrote the song, I wrote it with their kind of lyrical flow, you know, over the hook. And even like the second verse and stuff. And then I wanted them to write the bridge, and I had an idea, you know, for that break down. And then of course they came in and did it, like, and then they started that city break me all down. They like came up with that in 1 second, and then the roll on thing that they were doing. And so they came in and they listened to it, and I think they could definitely tell that it was very inspired by them. Crazy and Wishbone came in. We had quite the lengthy session. I was dying from allergies and stuff, but it was really, really good, and I'm just happy that it happened, you know.
So, again with Breakdown, I mean, Breakdown is a very serious song in parts too, you know? I mean, it's a pretty serious song.
My friend said, you're freaking me out. She listened to the song, and she was like, you know, you're like, it's so happy sounding, and you're like, da-da-da-da-da-da, and then you're like talking about breaking down. She's like, the song freaks me out, I can't listen to it. But, no, I mean, that was more of just like working off of a theme, you know? And I just started singing the break down part, and, you know, when I was in the studio. And then from there, I took it and made it about that. But that's like actually one of the least personal ones. But, you know, it could apply to anything. You know, I was just talking about how you work constantly and then you don't realize it when you're about to like fall down because you're so wrapped up in what you're doing. And you know, like when you're in the public eye, you have to constantly be on. And so you have to hold in a lot of stuff. So maybe subliminally, that's where I was coming from.
What I was going to say before, with, we were talking about how, you know, and you were saying it before of how, you know, you had a pretty hard life growing up. And look what's happened now with Bone Thugs and Harmony, with the boys, and talking to them during that interview. I was absolutely almost hypnotized by the stories they told me about Cleveland and how they got in their van and drove to see Eazy-E and he'd gone somewhere else, and and yet watching them work in the studio, I mean, they're really dedicated to their job, you know,
and they're just really cool and mellow.
Yeah, they are.
They were just, it was an easy session. I mean, it was a long session, but it was an easy session because they were just cool. They were not on an ego trip at all. I mean, and that's what I like to see, like, because I'm not. And sometimes when you meet people who do this, they're totally carried away with themselves and totally, you know, living like they're kings or something. Not living like kings, believing that they're kings or queens or whatever. Whichever, or both, or what have you. But
well, it depends what queens you're talking about, honey. I can tell you right now.
So exactly, but you know, it's. Anyway.
That's why I want to have a chat to you about the end of the first video of Honey. Anyway, go on.
Right. So, no, but they were just cool, you know, and they're really, people don't, they're quietly, like probably, I don't know if they're one of the biggest rap groups ever, because they consistently sell so many records, and they are setting, really trend setting.
Absolutely.
You know? So I'm just happy that it happened.
I mean, it's ironic because, I mean, I'm not sure what the charts are this week, but certainly in the top 10, I mean, you've got Puff and then you've got Bone Thugs and Harmony there in the, you know, at the same time.
Yeah.
No, I mean, they are talented, and they have broke, in my mind, the last album, and certainly Crossroads, broke through new ground in some respects.
Definitely. You know? And when I was singing that song, and I was doing my little, the chorus and stuff, the parts that are sung in their kind of flavor, I gain like even more respect for what they do, because it's not easy to do that rhythmic stuff when you sing that fast. I mean, it's like, oh, this is kind of challenging in a way. But it was interesting. It was challenging to write it and to sing it.
Okay, Outside, another song you've written with Walter.
Mm-hmm.
Again, a serious song.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us about it?
The song Outside is basically, I mean, I always hate to get too specific about stuff, because I think that song, a lot of people could relate to it for a lot of different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it was basically about being multiracial and feeling completely like in my own, like I come from another planet, because I never knew anyone in the exact same position as me in that way. I mean, I know other people that are mixed or things, but somehow, because of the way I look, because I'm so kind of ambiguous looking, I could be anything really. The experiences that I've had, just, you know, they've sort of made me feel like an outsider in a lot of ways in every situation that I'm in. I mean, less now, but then things will turn up that'll just kind of reinforce that inner feeling that rises every now and then.
Now, just on that, being Mariah Carey, and from the very first album of this rise of you as a performer, as a recording artist, as a songwriter, and then, you know, it was from success to success, you got married, were you wrapped up, do you think? And has that wrapping, is the Christmas present open now?
Here I am. No, I think that because I started doing this so young, and because I've been dedicated to being in this business for my whole life, like, yes, it happened very early on, you know, and I know that, and I'm totally grateful for that. But A, I would never have given up if it took 10 years. B, I've been wanting to do this since I was 4 years old, and I went through, like, prior to even getting my record deal, a lifetime of crazy experiences and struggles and things that I just don't even really talk about or address, because, you know, I don't think it's, like, my place to get up on a soapbox and sit there and go, whoa, it's me, you know?
Yeah,
it's like, who cares? Thank God I'm here, I'm alive, I'm happy, you know, I'm doing the music that I want to do, I'm living my life the way I want to live it. And, you know, the place where I'm at now is a good place.
But it can become, and I've seen it with so many artists who become stars, not only like singing artists, but even like from film stars to sports stars, you know, that it can become quite claustrophobic.
Right.
Because you've got certain commitments, you've got minders that have to mind after you,
right.
And you've got to, and they're thinking of the next thing you have to do, you know?
I think
that can become claustrophobic.
Oh yeah, it can totally become claustrophobic, and also the feeling that you can't just run outside and do what you want.
Mm.
That gives you kind of,
and you can lose self-confidence in that. I've found with some, you know, artists that they almost become introverted because they think, oh well, I can't do anything. You know?
Well, I went through that for a period of time, but Because it is difficult to go from no one knowing who you are and being a normal person to suddenly, like, people are recognizing you and looking at you and then judging you. And, you know, if you happen to, like, just roll out of bed and go to the deli and some guy snaps a picture of you, it could be, you know, in whatever little snazzy little magazine, you know. So it's you have to be guarded a little bit more. But I think people are surprised when they meet me that I am approachable, that I am, you know, that I am personable, that I do love people, you know, and love making friends and just hanging out and being real. I feel that I've stayed real in all this.
I mean, it's hard enough being a star that you are, and you are a superstar now, let alone until now, that you're married to, or were married to, a head of a record company, head of a huge corporation, who they, a lot of people think, are untouchable too, you know, that can't go near them, you know?
Right.
So you're having a double whammy here at times, you know? Now, I mean, like, looking at the video, right, hearing the songs, you know, I get to feel that you're so relaxed now, you know? That you are a Mariah Carey, you know?
I'm a lot more relaxed than I was, but it's also, you have to look at it that, imagine if, okay, you started writing songs like for your first album in high school, then like very little time went by, you actually made their first album and went in the studio year after year and did like, this is my fifth album, because you don't count the Christmas album or Unplugged.
No, I'm all right, it's the fifth
studio album. Yeah. But the Christmas album.
When you look at the MTV album, when you look at the Christmas album, you're selling about 8 million sales of them. I call it an album.
Well, I call it an album, but the record company don't count it as an album.
It's the fifth studio album.
If they count it as an album, I'd be free. But, no. You know, see, I mean, Unplugged took me half an hour to, you know, to make, because it was a TV show and it was a live performance. So going into the studio year after year, just, and writing and producing and, you know, and then go out and promote it, and then the pressure, and then people judging you and for your personal situations and all those things, and, you know, growing up basically in the process.
Can't imagine.
It's really difficult, and I'm at a place now where I feel really good about what I've done. If someone doesn't like it, they're never gonna like me. I don't care, and I can't begin to care, you know, in terms of a critic that just has a bone to pick with me. But as far as the fans go, you know, that's the important thing.
Well, I mean, the fans have stood there solid. And I mean, I, being a fan, and I'm ashamedly saying I'm a fan of yours, was so pissed off, you know, of the Grammys, when the song, of any song that should have won the Song of the Year, was the song with you and Boyz II Men, you know?
Thank you.
It proved in sales, but I mean, okay, sales are nothing when it comes to peers, but...
Right.
Did that disappoint you?
The one thing that...
I know it disappointed Boyz II Men, you know?
Yeah.
Not because it was just that they loved that song as well.
Right. The one
what
thing...
What it meant.
I mean, okay, I had 6 nominations, which were the most nominations of anyone there, which I didn't expect or, like, look for or think would even happen. But then it did, and then it was like everyone giving this whole hype, oh, you're the expected winner, and I'm like, whatever. I really wasn't counting on getting most of those things at all. I just knew it wasn't going to happen. So I was prepared for that. I wasn't like expecting it. But what really disappointed me was that One Sweet Day didn't get recognition, just because of the fact that so many people wrote to me about how it helped them.
It did.
You know, and the people that had lost friends and things, and I just felt that it was really kind of important, you know. Yeah, it was an R&B, but it was a pop record, so it wasn't as, I guess that they were more into an alternative thing that year, whatever was going on. But I just would have thought that could have gotten a little recognition, so I was disappointed about that. But, you know, what can you do? That's not what it's about. You know, it's about the people that were moved by the song and that were inspired or helped by the song.
So we've got 2 more tracks to get through, which I've just heard this one, and this one has blown me away. A Prince song from Purple Rain era, The Beautiful Ones. And yourself, Drew Hill, Trent, and there's another vocalist as well, isn't there?
Cisco.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
A, why the song? And it's just brilliant. A, why that song?
Well, The Beautiful Ones is my favorite Prince song ever, one of my favorite Prince songs. And, you know, I toyed around with the idea for a long time, and actually a friend of mine, Nick, kind of was like, no, you should definitely do that. When we were just doing the Honey video, he came down to Puerto Rico. We went to school together, and he's been one of my best friends for a really long time. And so I was like, you know, you're right, I really should do it. And so, I don't know, I'm just happy that, you know, Drew Hill, their voices, especially Cisco, it's such a contrast to me. And, it, you know, when I was, when that was out and we were like in high school and my friends and I went to go see that movie like 10 times in a row, that was just my favorite song. It stood out. I used to go home, sit and cry over this kid, Matt, that I used to be in love with. Turned out to be a jerk, but it was just, of all the remakes that I've done, it was really the closest to home because it's the one that's the closest to, you know, this stage in my life, you know.
I've always maintained with Prince that his songs, it's almost at times he's written them in mind of a female vocalist, because some of the songs that have been covered sound as good, if not, or dare I say, better. No, but they're great, you know. I mean,
right.
Sinead O'Connor,
right.
Sheena right. Easton, you know. Sheila Ree, I should say, and Sheena Easton, you know.
Right.
Manic Mondays, you know.
Well, probably because his voice, he has that range. Like, I know I tend to write in my upper register, and I'm much more of an alto in reality. I mean, people think of me as hitting all these high notes, but my natural voice is low. But for some reason, when I write, I always write in the higher register. I don't know why. But I thought it was an interesting idea to turn The Beautiful Ones into a duet.
Which works really well.
Yeah, and that's why, you know, they started it out, Cisco started out singing lower instead of higher.
It's still got that wonderful Prince.
Yeah, we tried to not take it. Devante did the track, and we tried not to take it too far from the original.
Oh, sounds good.
You know.
And even your vocals in that, because, you know, I mean, obviously the whole of Purple Rain is very guitar oriented.
Right.
Your vocals take in some of the guitar,
right.
Like the guitar thing that Prince would do.
Right.
Okay. Well, it's not the final track, but it's a track now I haven't heard. Close My Eyes.
Okay, I started writing Close My Eyes.
Oh, listen, just incidentally, which I've been amiss, in Baby Doll, I might add, because Trent is on The Beautiful Ones, but he's also on Baby Doll, right?
Oh, back Trey?
Yeah, Trey, I should say.
Well, Trey is actually not on The Beautiful Ones. They probably gave you the wrong credits. See, guys, that's what happens when you do stuff before the credits are actually submitted. But Trey is singing with me on Baby Doll.
Yeah.
And also on this remix that I just did with Jermaine and Brat of Honey. And yet another remix, but I love it. You gotta hear it. I don't have any copies of it yet, but it's really cool because, do you know Jermaine at all?
Yeah.
He's rhyming on it with Brat, like they did on the Drew Hill remix.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
really,
yeah.
Really cool. But what were we talking about? Trey.
With Trey, yeah.
Yeah, Trey and I can match. There's certain people that I really can, like, we have a similar sound, and he's one of them. And so I knew that I could sing him the parts that I wanted to do in my lower register, and he could lay them out in his upper register, and then I could add mine after in terms of the backgrounds, because I was sick, but I knew I had to get the song done. So we did it, we laid it out like that, and it was cool.
All right, Close My Eyes.
Okay.
Another song that you and Walter?
Yes. Well, what happened with Close My Eyes, the reason it's the last track on the album, I started writing that song 4 years ago, and I never do this. And I was up in this at this farm where we used to go every weekend, and I was actually in the bathtub. It was night. I was looking out at the moon, and it was just like this kind of introspective little moment thinking about, like, you know, my life and where I've been and what I've been through and stuff. And I just started singing it and writing, and I had the whole, basically, the essence of the song. And then I stopped and I never used it. And then this past year I sang it to Walter, and I just said, this is how, you know, this is it. I mean, the chords were already in my head. And then we kind of, you know, he laid that out, and then we did the bridge together. But I just finished the lyrics like a week ago. So it started from where I was 4 years ago to where I am now.
Wow.
But it's also kind of like dealing with like a lot of It's very personal. Some people might not even understand it. There are specific, I'm sure they won't, because there are things that only I know, you know, what they're about and what they're pertaining to. But it's all very personal and all very kind of introspective about my life and childhood and things.
Well, it's been a marathon, this one. These are the two albums. There's two different covers.
Very classy. It's the same album. It's one album.
Yeah, one album,
two different covers. Yep. So you can just, if you want one, they're both pictures are
and
on
they all
either
pull
album.
Out sort of thing, yeah.
Yeah, they all pull out. But I just, you know, spice it up a little. What the hey, you know, take some chances.
Okay, so that's done. Now the I mean, you're so relaxed. It's unbelievable. And yesterday, hearing, and you'll be working like a Trojan. I've got to tell you.
I know.
And doing interviews on the bed and everything
and
else like
pool.
That. And in the pool.
Well, it was 106 degrees.
So there's a, I mean, there is a very relaxed Mariah Carey, you know, this time around.
Mm-hmm.
The Mariah Carey I know has always been nervous about performing on stage live.
Well, I haven't seen you since, did I see you since the European, and did I see you since the European things?
Yeah, since the European, you're right.
European dates were really fun. Because the audience is so live and right there and in your face, and it was cool.
So, the inevitable question is, are you coming to Australia? Now, I know everyone says, yes, it's definite. I want to hear it directly from Mariah Carey.
I am most definitely...
Looking very relaxed here with the pool, no tension.
I am most definitely coming to Australia. I am totally looking forward to coming to Australia. I've always wanted to come to Australia, and now I will be there in January, definitely.
And... big band?
We got a whole number for you. Putting it together now.
And, I mean, we will get some of the old songs, won't we? From
of course. Yeah. No. It's like basically all my songs that have been popular and about 5 new tracks from the new album. Because I know what people want to see. They want to see their favorite songs, especially if you've never been there performing them. So I do everything from Vision of Love up until now.
Now, I'm not, as you know, an interviewer that asks what milkshakes you like and what colour, you know, is your favourite colour and that. But I would be slaughtered, I think, at home by a lot of the females and probably some of the males if I didn't ask the question, who is that guy in Honey at the end that you're dancing on the beach with?
His name is David Romero. He's a Cuban-American, and he is a model. And, you know... Dancing on up and down the surf.
Having a good time.